Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so.
Bible. So when they come back in?
Yeah.
Okay.
You hear the first bell, just ignore it.
Okay. All right, so when do I need to offer an invitation then?
Right.
Like, after, when I hear the first bell, go ahead and...
Yeah.
Okay. So just do like a preacher. Just ignore the clock, ignore the bells, and just... And I started preaching the gospel in 2002, and when I grow up, I want to be just like Brother Anderson. I have enjoyed our friendship over the last 15 or 16 years. As he mentioned, we had him, I believe, twice at Science Hill during my 9.5 years of preaching there. I believe Brother Gentry Whitworth was the first one to kind of discover you, if we can use that terminology, maybe at a Friday night scene. I know he traveled around quite extensively during the years going to those scenes, and had Brother Anderson come and do a meeting, and then we scheduled him again. I also believe we had him for several summer series speaking engagements as well, and so always enjoy being around him. Appreciate him so much for the work that he does. How many years have you been here now, Brother Anderson? 30? Really? 41 years. It's hard to imagine. As he said earlier, he remembers some of the parents now, their first vacation Bible school as well. And so it is a wonderful thing these days, especially to see someone to stay at a congregation and build it, and help it to grow and stay there and love the people. And it's wonderful on your part that you have continued to encourage him and enjoy the relationship that you have with him. And everyone here, I believe the mic is on, but it's kind of hard to tell from this end. So everybody's good? Good, good. Well, as was mentioned, we're going to be looking in Ephesians chapter 6 tonight. And I'm thankful to have the first lesson of the week. I'm going to begin by introducing a little bit of what is taking place in chapter 6 as it is connected to the entire lesson of the book, the message of the book of Ephesians. And now as Paul comes to the 6th chapter, he is continuing his attempt to instruct the brethren in Ephesus about the proper response to the blessing of being in Christ Jesus. Of course, when he begins in chapter 1 and verse 3, he tells the audience there that every spiritual blessing is connected to being in Christ Jesus. Everything that we are as Christians comes from that relationship that we have with God in His Son. Paul admonishes them to stand and to fight against the Christian enemy. And I believe that it is time for us as Christians to realize that we have been brought into a war that we had volunteered for when we obeyed the gospel of Jesus Christ. Our enemy no longer dominates the Christian, but at the same time, he will not stop trying to reclaim his control on our life. Paul wanted them to know that they could stand, that they could fight, and that in fact they must stand and fight against the enemy if they are going to claim the victory that has been won by the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So if you have your Bibles there in Ephesians chapter 6, notice with me verses 10 through 12. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. As he talks about fighting the good fight, he wants them to know that there is a very real enemy that is engaging against the Christian, that is attacking us every single day that we live, who never gives up and will continue until the time that either the Lord returns or we draw our final breath to reclaim victory over us. We need to understand that we do fight a very real enemy. And although he is not a physical enemy like those that maybe our country has engaged with in various wars throughout the years, nonetheless, it is a very real and very powerful enemy that we face as Christians. The Bible gives him several names. A couple of them I believe to be very significant when it comes to understanding not only who he is, but the ways in which he tries to attack us. For example, there are times where he is referred to as Satan, which means adversary. Obviously, an adversary is simply an opponent or one who strives against another. An adversary would be an enemy. Of course, Satan is our adversary as Christians. He strives against us. He's also referred to as the devil, which means a slanderer, one who offers false or malicious statements against another. There are times, certainly in the Bible, that we see the enemy of God slandering his good name. We'll talk about that in just a moment. Certainly he tries to ruin the reputation and defame the name of Christians everywhere throughout this world. The Bible tells us in 1 Peter 5, verse 8, he is a roaring lion, walking about seeking whom he may devour. We must be on guard. We must be on the lookout for, sober-minded, as we face our enemy. Jay Lockhart, in his commentary on the book of Ephesians, writes this. He said, "Our battle is not against an enemy who can be seized, cut down with a sword, or shot with a gun. It is the demonic forces whose weapons are lies, false doctrines, counterfeit religions, false philosophies, and clever perversions of truth. Our adversary is a spiritual being whose headquarters are in the unseen realms of another dimension." You know, we think about the fact that we do have a very real enemy in which we engage as Christians, and yet we must also understand that he is not on the same level when it comes to his beginning, when it comes to his power and strength, as the God who created us and the God that we serve. In fact, when we think about the fact that God created all things, then it stands to reason that God, having created man and angels, would also have then created our enemy. Of course, God, as he looked at creation, noted that everything that had been created, we don't know exactly whether or not the angels were created at the same time as man, or perhaps had been created prior to the creation week. But God is the giver of all things that are good. God is the creator of all things that are good, and thus the angels themselves would have been created in the same way that man was, created as being good, and yet also given the ability, like man, to make choices. And the Bible speaks of certain angels that chose to rebel and turn against God. Those angels that were cast down, and reserved unto a future time of judgment. 2 Peter 2, verse number 4. We think about this enemy's character. Jesus tells us in John 8 that he is a liar and a murderer. You remember in John chapter 8 that Jesus was talking with many of the Jews that continually tried to trap him, they tried to remove him. These were individuals that made it their daily mission to try to get Jesus out of the scene, as it were, so that they themselves could maintain their position and their status. And Jesus tells these proud Jews who place all of their confidence in the fact that they were Jews and had come through the lineage of Abraham, that they were in fact the children of their father. And their father was not Abraham, and their father was not God, but their father was the devil. And the devil is a liar and a murderer from the beginning. We find in 1 John 3:8 that he is a sinner. We find in 1 Timothy 3 and verse 6 that he was filled with pride. And so we find our enemy's character as well as his goal in the scriptures. He desires to be worshipped. You remember in Matthew chapter 4 as he tempted our Lord, that he wanted our Lord to fall down before him, to worship him. His desire is to be admired and worshipped by all. We note also that his desire is to tempt us. 1 Thessalonians 3 and verse 5, as well as to devour us. 2 Peter 5 and verse number 8. Or 1 Peter 5 verse 8 rather. We find here that he uses Paul calls them wiles to try and accomplish his goal. This word wiles here means strategies, devices, methods. Our enemy will use every strategy that he can to bring about our downfall. Paul warned Timothy about the snare of the devil. 1 Timothy 3 verse 7, 2 Timothy 2 verse 26. When we think about these devices in which he uses, we know that they can be found in the warning of the Apostle John. You remember John's warning in 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. He talked about the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life being those avenues in which the enemy attacks the child of God. When you go back to the very beginning of time and you see the first sin in the Garden of Eden, you see that the enemy there used these wiles or these strategies or devices to bring sin and death into the world. We find how subtle he was there in the very beginning as he dealt there with Eve, as he preyed upon her lack of knowledge of completely those things and the danger in which she was involved. Obviously, she knew what God had commanded. He questioned her about that. Has God forbidden every tree of the garden? She knew what God had said. Adam had relayed that message to his wife. They were had a full understanding of God's will. Every tree was theirs to eat, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, that tree was forbidden. And so he began to introduce doubt into her mind. Doubt as to the motive of God. What is God trying to withhold from you? It's something that will benefit you in your life. If you just take of that tree, you'll be like God. And so the Bible says when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat. Gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And so he came in her very subtly, very craftily, as he works against us today. We find him later in Matthew chapter 4, trying these same avenues against our Lord, tempting him there in the wilderness in the same way that he tempted Eve in the garden. And yet he was unsuccessful against our Lord with these same attacks. And the fact is, he continues to attack us in the same ways, coming at us, exploiting our weaknesses, tempting us in a variety of ways, using these fleshly desires that we have in the battle that is taking place within our life each and every single day to try to bring about our destruction. And so Paul here warns them in chapter 6 that there is a war to be fought. There is a battle to be engaged in. And so when we come then to chapter 6, beginning verse 13, dropping down through verse 17, we're going to notice that the Christian is prepared for the good fight by putting on the whole armor of God. Notice here, beginning verse 13. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace, above all taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And so after letting them know that there is a war to be fought, a battle to engage in as Christians, to fight against our enemy, who is certainly fighting against us, he tells them that the battle is won and can be won by the Christian if we put on the armor of God. Notice here, he tells them to be strong in the Lord. The war that we are engaged in, as I mentioned a moment ago, is not a war with flesh and blood. It's not a physical battle, one that we can take in our hands, physical weapons, and win. But rather, it is a war with Satan and his forces. Paul said that we wrestle against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Paul was most likely not designating different kinds or levels within the ranks of our enemy, but the fact that our enemy is spiritual, that our enemy is evil, and that our enemy should not be taken lightly by the child of God. You see, our strength for this good fight comes from the Lord. As the song says that we sung to begin our session tonight, and the song that serves as the theme for this Vacation Bible School, the battle belongs to the Lord, but the Lord has given us as Christians armor that we are to wear in order to be engaged in this battle and to do so and win. And so we think about this armor of God and the fact that it must be put on by the Christian. God has done his part in supplying his children with all that we need. But we must make the decision to put on the armor of God. We must make the decision to fight against our enemy. God will not force us to put on the armor of God. Those who love us cannot put it on for us. We must make the decision to put on the armor of God. That's why Paul said, "Take unto you the whole armor of God." This is something that every Christian must decide for themselves that they need, that they will benefit from, and that is worth putting on and going to battle with. And so he tells us here, as we look at some of these just in overview and then come back to our two for tonight. First of all, he says that we're to gird our loins with truth. I don't think that we can underestimate the essentiality of truth in the life of a Christian. We need to have our loins girt about with truth. We need to have the stability that comes with the Word of God. Secondly, he says we must put on the breastplate of righteousness. The breastplate was worn around the chest of the soldier as a means of protecting his heart and internal organs. You think about today as those officers go out and they perform their duties as they try to protect and serve, how dangerous it has become in our world today, and how many individuals have thoughts in their minds of trying to hurt someone, especially someone who represents law and order, and how they'll wear those bulletproof vests as they try to protect those internal organs, as they try to protect themselves against those out in the world that might strive to do them harm. Well, here the Christian is told to put on the breastplate of righteousness that they might do the same thing. It was an essential piece of the armor and would keep one safe against the attack of the sword, the spear, or an arrow. Just as essential for the protection of the Christian heart is the breastplate of righteousness. We are made righteous by the sacrifice of Jesus and by our being in Him, 2 Corinthians 5:21, Ephesians 4:24. Also, we must be righteous in all our thoughts and all of our actions, striving to take into our heart those sayings that are of great virtue, as Paul talks about in the book of Philippians chapter 4 and verse 8, while at the same time trying to keep out those things from our heart that would corrupt us in our daily walk with God. We must put on the shoes of the gospel of peace. We'll be coming back to that one here in just a few moments as we continue our study here. We must take to us the shield of faith. The shield of the soldier was large enough to provide complete protection for the fiery darts of the enemy. Again, Brother J. Lockhart writes of the shield. He said, the edges of these shields were so constructed that an entire line of soldiers could lock their shields together and move against the enemy like a solid wall, thus reminding us that even though we individually put on the armor, we do not fight the battle alone. We have God as our commander-in-chief and one another to stand side by side and engage the enemy together. The shield that protects the Christian is our faith. Faith is the foundation upon which our lives are built. Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 1. The substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Faith is not, as some want us to believe, a close your eyes and hope for the best approach to life, but rather faith is something that is built upon substantial evidence that God has given us in nature as well as in His Word, so that we are able to walk by faith and not by sight, and yet understand and believe that God is and that He rewards those who diligently seek Him. It was faith that allowed Abel to offer a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. It was faith that allowed Noah to build the ark exactly as God commanded it to be built. It was faith that allowed Abraham to travel away from his home to a place where he had never been before, and allowed Sarah to follow him, calling him Lord. It is faith that will allow us to stand victoriously against the enemy today, 1 John 5 and verse number 4. We must put on the helmet of salvation. The helmet was worn for protection for the head. Headshots can distort vision. They can cause you to lose consciousness on the battlefield, and at times they can be fatal. Brother J. Lockhart writes that the Christian's mind has full assurance of salvation. When God rescues our mind from the corrupt thinking of the age and begins to control our thought processes, Satan cannot lead us astray. When we study God's Word, when we ground ourselves firmly in its principles, we will not be gullible to Satan's deceptions. We will be able to fight our daily battles out of the certainty of our salvation. And then we must use the sword of the Spirit. The sword was used both for defense as well as offense. The Christian is to use the Word of God to go on the attack against the enemy. Not only are we to defend ourselves, to defend our position to stand, but we are to move forward. We are to attack the enemy. The Word of God is that which allows us to go forward and to attack the enemy that we fight against. We think about the Hebrew writer's words in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, where he talks about the fact that the Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. It is a living and active Word that God has given us that we use as we go into battle. The Word of God can be hidden within us to safeguard us against sin. Psalm 119, verse 11. With the Word of God, Jesus was able to defeat Satan in Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 11. And so we have an overview of what is taking place here in Ephesians chapter 6. But let's go back then, and let's think a little more in depth about what is being said here in this particular passage. Let's go back to the idea of having our loins girt about with truth. Let's go back to what he says here in verse 14. After telling them that you're engaged in a warfare, to telling them that they are at battle, he tells them to take unto you the whole armor of God. But then he says in verse 14, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness. We think about truth. We think about having our loins girt about with truth. The loins has to do with the midsection of the individual. When you began to read and study and think about the soldiers that Paul would have seen as he was arrested there when writing the book of Ephesians, he would have been extremely familiar with that which they wore. It would have been a visual picture that he was trying to paint for those in Ephesus to think about what they were to put on as Christian soldiers as they fight. And you think about this loin being girded with truth. The soldier would wear a girdle or belt that would serve as the connection between the lower and upper parts of the uniform. As Christians, it is true that helps us identify, and it is true that helps us defeat the schemes of our enemy. It is true that holds together the Christian life. We think about the essentiality of truth, and there's so much that we could say about truth. In fact, really, when you begin to look at Ephesians chapter 6 and the armor of God, really, when you think about all that's being said here, the Word of God, truth, the gospel, these are things that come from what God has inspired and written and left for us. And so truth is so important. I know you said there'd be a couple of bells. That one seemed really early. Any idea what time we're... Okay. That one seemed really early, I thought. Okay, about the midpoints. Great, thank you. And so truth. Why do we need to have truth as a part of that which binds everything together in our life? I want to share with you just a couple of thoughts about truth from the Word of God. Why it is so essential. Why it is compared to the girdle that binds everything together in the soldier's life. The first thing I want to think about is the fact that truth is cleansing in our life. You know, man is in need of being cleansed. Certainly we understand that from the Scriptures. We know that we need to be made pure. We need to be made clean. We live in a world that is in darkness. Ephesians 5, verse number 8. We know that in the world that there is sin that is prevalent in people's lives, that we see so much sin being enacted in the world in which we live. We see so many that are separated from God, but truth is that which can cleanse us. We think about the words of John 17, verse 17, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. Truth is cleansing. It sanctifies. It sets us apart for the use of God. And so here Paul is writing to the church at Ephesus, reminding them that they're in Christ Jesus, that all blessings come from that relationship with God, reminding them that they're at war with an enemy who is real and powerful, and reminding them that they have been set apart by God for His use, His service, and that it is the truth that sets us apart, that sanctifies us. You know, we think about that cleansing that comes from the truth and how it culminates in the waters of baptism. Listen to what Paul wrote in Ephesians 5, 25 and 6. He said, husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word. And so we are the called out. We're the church, cleansed by the washing of water by the word. In other words, the word of truth teaches man of his need to be baptized so that he can contact the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Likewise, it is through our faithful obedience that we continue to be cleansed by the blood of Christ. 1 John chapter 1, verses 7 through 9. And so when he says, I want you to have your loins girt about with truth, he's telling them that I want you to be in contact with the inspired word of God that cleansed you and continues to cleanse you as you obey it in your daily life. It will safeguard you and preserve you against the enemy. Secondly, truth is certain. The word certain means being very sure of something, without any doubt, inevitable. We know that God's word is truth, and that as God's word, it is certain. God cannot lie. Titus 1, verse 2. Therefore, what he says is truth. Again, Jesus prayed, thy word is truth. You remember when our Lord was talking to the apostles there in John chapters 13 through 16, that he reminded them, that he taught them and instructed them that it wouldn't be long and he would be taken away. As you might imagine, that was devastating news to the apostles. They had put all of their confidence, all of their trust in Jesus, that he was the Messiah, and now he's going to be taken away. But he lets them know that it's for their benefit, because as he goes away, the Holy Spirit comes, and he'll be in heaven watching over the church, and the Holy Spirit will be guiding them into all truth. So that as they go forth with this word from God, they know that they're not relying on their own knowledge, but rather they're speaking a word that is true, that is certain. You know, as we as Christians fight against our enemy, we need to know that this book is from God, that this book can be relied upon, that it will never let us down, but that it is certain. Truth can be known. Jesus said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. John 8 and verse 32. Therefore, truth is objective rather than subjective. In the epistle of 1 John, great emphasis is given to the word know. It's one of the themes of that book. The idea that you can know, that you can know, that you can know, that you don't have to live with doubt, that you don't have to live like many who are always wondering and worrying, but that you can know that there's something that is true, that is right, and cannot be wrong. That's truth. And Paul said, as Christian soldiers, let your loins be girded with that truth that is certain. But also, it is complete. It is all sufficient. 2 Timothy 3, 16 and 17. For doctrine, reproof, correction, instruction in righteousness, it is perfect, complete, and mature. We began as babes in Christ, but we grow and mature as we take in the complete Word of God. This Word is finished. It has been once for all time revealed, Jude and verse number 3. All that they had at one time, those spiritual gifts, were done in part, Paul said. But that which was to come, that which was to be complete, the Bible, has come from God. No longer does man need the miraculous, because now we have that which is complete. This is why many of the so-called modern-day revelations are so dangerous, because they create doubt. They create uncertainty. They tell us that the Bible is not sufficient. They tell us that the Bible is not complete. And they lead many people away from God and right into the grip of our enemy, because they do not have that assurance that comes from knowing that truth is complete. As we go into battle, we need to know that every part of the armor of God, including the truth, will never let us down. We must have full confidence that God has given us everything that we need. Isn't that what Peter said in his writings there, that God has given us all things that pertain unto life and godliness? God has not left us at the mercy of our enemy, but rather he has completely given us everything that we need. But then also, truth is constant. What was true yesterday will be true today, and will be true tomorrow, and will be true as long as this world stands. The Word of God never changes, because God never changes. Malachi 3:6 says, for I am the Lord, I change not. Jesus said, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. Matthew 24:35. Through Jesus, God is speaking to man today. Hebrews 1:1 and 2. Why is this so important? is so important because as we have our loins girt about with truth, we need to have that confidence that the Word of God is current, that it is relevant. There are individuals in our world who try to convince us that though the Bible may be a good book, that it may have been important at one time, that no longer is it necessary for an enlightened culture in which we live. And yet the fact is that the Bible came from a God who is able to see the beginning and the end and everything in between all at the same time, who would know the needs of His creation until the time that He draws this world to a close, and thus was able to provide us with a truth that is constant and unchanging. And so we need to know and live by the Word of God. We need to know that what we learn today will be relevant tomorrow and forever. Suppose you were taking an algebra class in school and you were using the algebra book, and then you were tested on your knowledge of calculus. How unfair would that be of the teacher to grade you that way? And yet when it comes to our life, God is not going to switch on us at the final moment, but rather He has given us His Word. He has commanded us to learn it and live by it. And He has told us in John chapter 12, verse 48, that from the words of Jesus, we will be judged. We need to know that this is the book. This is the source that we go to that is constant and unchanging. Paul said here to them very clearly, have your loins girt about with truth. Truth is essential to our life as Christians. But let's think about the shoes of the gospel of peace. He continues there in verse 14 and 15, having on the breastplate of righteousness and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. You know, we think about the soldier and how they often would travel from place to place. They did not have many of the comforts that are given to armies today, in which they're able to travel very quickly from place to place, oftentimes in vehicles that will protect them against certain kinds of the enemy advances. They would walk from place to place on foot. They certainly would engage the battle one-on-one as they would fight there standing upon their feet. And thus we understand the importance of the shoes that would be worn by the soldier, not only for the protection of the feet, but more importantly, the shoes needed to be fitted so that there would be stability, so that there would be strength, so that not only as they defended themselves, but as they advanced, taking the sword of the Spirit, that they might be able to fight with success. If one lost their footing in the midst of battle, no matter how good the rest of their armor was, they could have on the helmet, they could have on the breastplate, they could have everything where it needed to be, but if their footing was lost and they fell in the midst of battle, they would be easy prey for the enemy that they fought. And we understand the importance of having the proper shoes when doing certain things in our life. Brother Anderson mentioned that I had had plenty of time to study and prepare for tonight. In actuality, we were gone all last week. We were at Walt Disney with the family and walking, if you've ever been there, probably about 10 miles a day. And I certainly know the importance of having good shoes. In fact, about a month or a month and a half ago, I went and bought some new shoes. Wanted to break them in, make sure they were ready to go, because having been there several times, I know the importance of the shoes that you wear. One night I went out with an old pair of shoes, and by the time we got back to the hotel, I put those away, never got them out of the bag again because they had absolutely killed my feet. He tells these Christian soldiers, you need to make sure that you're prepared with the right kind of shoes. Shoes that are going to be fit for the battle. The idea here seems to be one of preparation for this battle that's going to take place in the Christian's life. I'm reminded of an Old Testament passage. In fact, if you have your Bibles, turn over to Ephesians or Exodus chapter 12. Exodus chapter 12. And if you recall what's happening here in Exodus chapter 12, God has, through Aaron and Moses, delivered 10 plagues against the people there, the Egyptians, and he's told his people that there's coming a time very quickly in which you're going to leave captivity behind. And you're going to need to be ready for that time to come. And I want you to notice what the Bible says here in verse number 11. Exodus chapter 12, of course, they're to be eating the Passover lamb as they prepare for this Passover event in which the blood is sprinkled there on the door post and the lintel, and death comes to the Egyptian houses. But notice verse 11. And thus shall ye eat it, with your loins girded, your shoes on your feet, and your staff in your hand. And ye shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. And so the Israelites were commanded by God in preparation for this Passover and what would transpire after that to make sure that their loins were girded, that they were prepared, that their shoes were on, and that they were ready to leave when the time came. You know, that which gives the Christian soldier his sure footing is the gospel of peace. You know, the enemy that we face, again, is real. And so we must be ready to stand. The battle is sure. And so we must be ready to fight. Yet the Christian remains at peace, knowing that there is nothing that the enemy can do to him so long as he is properly attired. We must be resolved that God is in control. We must be assured that the battle belongs to the Lord. You know, I think about the Apostle Paul, and I think he is a great example to us as Christians of the attitude that we need to have in our life. When Paul wrote the book of Ephesians, Paul had been arrested. His crime was preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ and trying to help people understand that the scriptures from the Old Testament had been fulfilled and that Jesus was the long-awaited Messiah, and that through his coming, his death, and resurrection, the church or kingdom had been established, and that all must enter it to be a child of God. Well, as you might expect, that message was not well received in that day and age. And so as he came and he began in the synagogues and then worked out among the Gentiles, there would often be those who would stand and oppose him. And there were several times where he was arrested for preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so this is one of those occasions. So he's writing here, having been arrested, and yet he's still writing Ephesians, Colossians, Philemon, and Philippians, what we sometimes call the prison epistles. So he's there, having been arrested, freedom taken away. We know that he was hated and mistreated and abused time and time again. All you have to do is look at 2 Corinthians 11, verses 24 through 28. Think about the abuse that Paul endured at the hands of the Jews and Gentiles and how he was hated by everyone that he came in contact with. But yet, notice Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4. Notice what Paul writes here. He says, "Be careful or anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God, and the peace of God which passeth all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus." Paul says to the church at Ephesus, have your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. The good news that Jesus came, died, was buried, and arose the third day, that he ascended to heaven and sits at the right hand of God, is a message of hope and peace for every Christian life. To know that God is in control. that God has made peace between Jew and Gentile. But more importantly, that God has made peace between Himself and man. Not that God had wronged us, but that we had wronged Him by sinning against Him. Have your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. You know, we think about an occasion like this where we've gathered together, and I realize, having grown up in the church and having been to countless amounts of vacation Bible schools, that a great majority of the people here tonight are members of the Lord's church. And it's certainly wonderful when we have the opportunity to come together and assemble as children of God and sing songs of praise and bow our heads in prayer and study God's Word. And I certainly am so delighted for the opportunity to be a part of this Vacation Bible School effort. But even as Christians, there are times when we do not do what God would have us to do, where we fall short of the glory of God, where we give in to temptation, where we allow the enemy to overcome us, and when we need to turn to God and confess our faults to Him and ask Him for forgiveness through prayer. There may be someone here tonight who is in that situation. You've been fighting against the enemy, but you've allowed him to overcome you. And your desire may be, as a Christian, to turn back to God and ask Him for forgiveness, and to ask Him for strength, and let your spiritual family know of your desire to recommit your life to God, and to have their strength to help you to be faithful. And it may be that there's someone here tonight who's not a child of God, who needs to understand that God has done everything for you that He can possibly do, short of forcing you to obey His will. God will not do that. He sent His Son to die on the cross for our sins. His Son rose victoriously from the grave. He stands at the door tonight knocking. But we must let Him into our lives. Maybe you're here tonight and you need to obey the gospel. You need to become a Christian and have your sins taken away by the blood of Jesus Christ. If you have faith tonight in God, if you believe in His Son, Jesus Christ, why not be willing to come forward to confess that faith before those who are gathered here this evening? Those of us who are Christians have been where you are. We've had to make that decision in our life. We've had to stand before others and confess with our mouth what we believe to be true in our heart, that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. If you're ready to make that decision, to repent and turn away from sin, we'll take you tonight and baptize you for the remission of your sins, that you might be added to the body of Christ by God Himself. Leave here tonight with confidence that you're on the side of God, that you're ready to enter into the battle, and that He's given you everything that you will need to be victorious. Do you need to do that tonight? Maybe you're here tonight and you're simply struggling. You haven't given in to temptation, but Satan is coming at you and he's throwing everything that he has at his disposal against you every single day. You want to be faithful to God. You want to fight against him. But you know that you're struggling and you're hurting, and maybe you simply want your brothers and sisters in Christ to come together and pray for you. We don't know what's going on in each other's life. Oftentimes we try to hide what we're facing from each other. If you have a need tonight, we ask you to come. Together we stand and sing.